A century ago, there arose a man with remarkable foresight. His sustained endeavors culminating in lighting the lamp of knowledge, igniting the flame of advanced scientific studies and technological research in the country. The Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. And the great visionary behind this glorious thought was Jamshedji Nasirwanji Tata. Jamshedji Tata was born in a Parsi family in the year 1839. Tata came to Bombay for higher studies and passed out as a green scholar. Devotion, dedication, and diligence were the hallmark of Tata's traits. He joined his father's business and soon acquired proficiency in trade matters. But cotton industry attracted him the most. In 1877, Tata started the Empress Mill at Nagpur. Tata's goal was on the production of goods of high quality, not just for acquiring huge profits, but primarily as a principle of business ethics. Over the years, Tata's presence in Bombay bore a distinct stamp. Who can miss out on the Taj Mahal Hotel at Mumbai? His wise and imaginative investment in properties and the financial gains that accrued to him from his companies made Tata one of the wealthiest persons in the country.
Jamshedji Nasirwanji Tata was a remarkable man. And as Jardi Tata said later, he lived in both the worlds. The world of ideas and the world of action. He lived at a time when there were remarkable developments in science, particularly in the West and more so in the last quarter of the 19th century. There was the discovery of X-rays, radioactivity, discovery of electron and so on. He visited the Western countries frequently and was impressed by their progress on three lines. One, the multi-level industrial development, two, higher education and training, and three, scientific research.
In 1893, Tata had an opportunity to sail with Swami Vivekananda. Later, in his letter to Swamiji, Tata wrote, "I recall these ideas in connection with my scheme of a research institute of science in India."
He devised three schemes. One was the generation of electricity by hydroelectric scheme. The second was the establishment of an iron and steel factory. And the third was the higher education.
Born out of the vision of Sri J. N. Tata, this institution is born out of his conviction that India, certainly if it has to play its rightful role among the community of nations, does need research as an important component of its academic activities.
Tata was fully engrossed in plans for establishing an institution for higher learning in science.
So he was contemplating to think of a higher educational institution, and in that connection he wrote a letter to Lord Rye, the governor of Bombay and also chancellor of the Bombay University, expressing his intention to start an institute of higher learning.
With the help of an educationist, Buljorji Pacha, he drew up a scheme, tentatively titled the Teaching University of India, and presented to Lord Curzon, the then British Viceroy. The university scheme itself underwent changes as a result of the reviews by William Ramsay, a Nobel laureate. Ramsay preferred the name Indian Institute of Research and declared, "I unreservedly select Bangalore as an ideal place for such an institute." Tata secured the consent of the Maharaja of Mysore for a gift of 372 acres of land.
Through a generous funding support that he gave, as well as the land that was gifted by the then Maharaja of Mysore, His Highness Krishnaraja Vadayar IV, this institute came into being.
It was perhaps the irony of fate that Jamshedji Nasirwanji Tata did not live to see the birth of his brainchild. The legend of a personality breathed his last in 1904 and buried in Brookwood Cemetery at London. But his spirit remained the immortal guiding force behind the formation of his dream institution. In 1909, the vesting order was issued by the Government of India for actual establishment of the Indian Institute of Science. The institute, most popularly known as Tata's Institute, opened its doors to students in 1911. The sedate but imposing central building of the Indian Institute of Science instantly strikes as a seat of knowledge. The statue of the founder in front of the central building stands as a proud picture of satisfaction, caressing the institution that he designed to create new technology frontiers. The inscription at his feet records a grateful tribute to the founder, his foresight, patriotism, and his perception of the benefits of advanced research. The first three directors were the British chemists Maurice Travers, A.G. Bourne, and M.O. Foster. During the directorship of Maurice Travers, the construction of the building commenced with the architecture still reminiscent of colonial ambience.
This institute has a very interesting history. Many know it just started with two departments, applied chemistry and electrical technology. So basically it was started as an application-based institution where the R&D carried out at this institute was essentially applicable to various facets of development of the country.
The initial period of 25 years from 1909 to 1934 was a cycle of consolidation. From a meadow status, the institute built up a reputation of its own among the various universities in the country. It launched several scientific investigations, the findings of which provided the data resource for setting up certain critical industries in the country. the Nobel laureate in physics, Sir C.V. Raman, to head the institute as the first Indian director. With him came a new department of applied physics. With a scientist at the helm, every other discipline of the institute was also a beehive of R&D activities. Homi J. Bhabha set up a cosmic ray research laboratory at the institute. He created a research team that included the likes of Vikram Sarabhai. It was a confluence of great characters when Mahatma Gandhi visited the institute during the directorship of C.V. Raman. In 1940s, the institute was navigated along a course of carefully planned expansion under the directorship of J.C. Ghosh. In 1958, the institute was declared a deemed university. The new status empowered it to award degrees including PhD, ME and BE. The year 1959 witnessed the Golden Jubilee celebrations. President Dr. Rajendra Prasad, in his message, complimented the leading role of the Institute as a premier scientific forum, credited with worldwide recognition. Prestigious honorary fellowship of IISc were conferred on Jawaharlal Nehru, C.V. Raman, and M. Visveshwaraya. Every change of guard brought in its wake a breath of fresh thinking and innovative approach. So it was when Satish Dhawan took over as the director.
Professor Satish Dhawan, he is my guru in many respects. And when he was a director of, when he was a professor in the Department of Aeronautics, I have closely worked with him. When he was a director of Institute of Science, at that time, I was in ISRO, and many research programs, simulation program, particularly digital, analog digital simulation program, he initiated.
Many, many new activities which Dr. Dhawan introduced in terms of research, in terms of administration, and I think he had a tenure of something like 17 years, probably the longest serving director at that point of time. And I believe his liberal thinking and vision was the one that really put this institute at the top of many other institutions in this country.
Aerospace Engineering. Established in 1942, the department, right from inception, has kept pace with progress in aeronautics and space technology, particularly joining hands with Hindustan Aeronautics.
The fact that we were here I mean both HAL and Indian Institute of Science have a department here, actually attracted all other aeronautical institutions to Bangalore. National Aerospace Laboratories, Aeronautical Development Establishment, and several others came to Bangalore because we were providing the right manpower and the right ambience for aeronautics in this country.
Hydraulics Laboratory in Civil Engineering. Not to be outdone are the achievements in improving the efficacy of wastewater treatment plants.
The institute has a rich tradition of both the operation of cryogenic plants as well as the cryogenic research activities.
The center currently has two liquid nitrogen plants and a liquid helium installation. Cryogenic technology has opened up new vistas for in-house researchers.
The center is working on some of the current areas of research, like development of many cryogenic systems, several specialized cryogenic systems.
We are mainly working on solid state chemistry. Here we deal with low dimensional, that is layered materials, and smaller size rhizium materials like nanomaterials. During my PhD work, I happened to work with many of the campus facilities. You can approach any of the laboratories anytime without any hesitations.
Quest for knowledge amidst the setting of enchanting greenery and captivating flowers. What more to whet the appetite for higher learning?
The ambience of the campus is very nice. You can easily ease out your stress because it's so green. And the green is actually very naturally green. It has not been tailored. So it looks very nice.
No wonder that track record is replete with creditable achievements, both in academic and research. IISC, therefore, is one of the most sought-after destinations among the intelligentsia. On to its centenary year, IISC assumed a preeminent position in promoting research on a wide spectrum of disciplines. The Institute has pioneered investigations in communication, electronics, electrical, metallurgical, chemistry, physics, genetic engineering, earth system science, nanoscience, and more.
To determine the stress intensity factor, we have different techniques.
Starting with just 24 students in 1911, IISC today has over 2,000 students. 400 out of them are female. Additionally, 1,250 scientists are busy in various research activities. Underlining the importance of knowledge exchange in a fast globalizing world, IISC established a number of collaborative programs with foreign institutions. The Indo-French cell is engaged in the research of quantifying the complex interaction between the hydrological and biogeochemical cycles. The study would be of immense help to forecast the global change in the context of the continental ecosystem.
We want to increase this collaboration with French laboratories in the near future. And it is why we want to set up a new frame for the Indo-French collaboration and the institute as an international mixed or joint laboratory.
Supercomputer Education Research Center. Established in 1990, the center provides state-of-the-art computing facilities to the staff and students, sophisticated software packages, backed by powerful high-speed networking. A vital organ in the institute's infrastructure is the central facilities. For instance, horticulture section is the caretaker of campus ecology. Not only that, it offers avenues for research in plant physiology and plant genetics. You have to see to believe it. Glass blowing could be mind-boggling. No Way Secondary is the animal facility center.
All the research activities that are going on using animals are with the idea that in the future there should be some benefit to the society, and this will enable us to find out infectious diseases like tuberculosis, HIV, as well as the dreaded disease cancer.
In the biology division in the institute, one of the major thrust areas of research is in infectious diseases. In the bacterial pathogens, one of the major areas of research has been on tuberculosis. The outcome of these research activities would be identification of important molecules and machinery in the bacterial pathogen so that one could design drugs against these molecules and also vaccines.
Center for Sustainable Technologies, formerly known as ASTRA, that is Application of Science and Technology to Rural Areas, has been an innovative approach of the Indian Institute of Science.
It involves touching the lives of masses through bioenergy, alternative building technology, and various other developments. Generation of electricity from waste wood is an example. This technology is widely accepted by developing countries.
The library at the Indian Institute of Science is one of the very early departments to start. In 1911, the library got established. It has one of the largest collection of science articles, journal periodicals, books, technical reports, standards. Total holding today is roughly about 5 lakhs. We also procure more than 1,500 journals every year, and these are accumulated into bound volumes for later, and about 2,000 books are procured every year.
Over the last 2 years, this library has been a great help to me and several students like me. It's got a huge collection of research papers and journals, and they cover every field imaginable. And not only for academic purposes, this library is an amazing place for you or any student to come over with his or her laptop because it's completely connected by Wi-Fi.
We have around 15,000 alumni. In this centenary year, we propose to reach out around 10 to 12,000 alumni throughout the world. It is customary that every March 3rd, IISc Alumni Association conducts alumni events. Our IISc alumni are on the upbeat and are looking forward to celebrate an excellent centenary year during 2008.
IISc, with its backdrop of 100 years of research, has been adopted as the mother institution by the Central Power Research Institute, Bangalore, Central Food Technology Research Institute, Mysore, and the Mysore Soaps and Detergents Limited, Bangalore, to mention a few. A judicious blend of scientific and technological research along with education enables several scientists to secure national and international acclaim. the ever-expanding horizon of science and technology beckons young and bright talents to play an effective role in the country's progress. Future plans of IISc are rightly oriented towards this goal.
Some of the important areas which will occupy our attention in the immediate future are the areas of nanoscience and nanoengineering. We are in the process of building new laboratories for nanoscience and engineering. We are also building a large laboratory for biological sciences, which will integrate all the activities in the area of biology under one roof. The institute is trying to set up a new campus, and in this new campus, I hope we will have the space to build many of the activities that are essential in the future.
IISc symbolizes a vital link towards continuity in the scientific heritage of the country, extending from several centuries ago to the present millennium. IISc's contribution is visible in every field.
I would like to, at the outset, congratulate all the members of the academic community, the staff, and the student for sustaining and keeping up the excellence that this institution is well known for.
That this institute has to try very hard to keep with the competition and continue to be a prominent science institute of the future. For this, the younger faculty members, younger people of the institute have to do much more. I have no doubt, if everything working well, this institute will continue to be one of the world's best.
Now the time has come, Indian Institute of Science has become a global institute of science, and should have a standing in the academic world for research.
For 100 years, it has set a new trail. For 100 years, it has been the beacon light. For hundreds of years more, this lamp of knowledge, kindled by Jamshedji Nasirwanji Tata, will continue to ignite scientific minds towards global welfare.